Bing, 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 bing. Bing, bing, bing. I think it's... Whoa, where are you? Where am I? Oh, no, where am I? Oh, that's why. That's why. Because I'm the wrong person. I'm logged on as the wrong person. Are you ready, Bob? Click to expand. Bang.
Are you ready, Bob?
Oops, sorry.
Click to expand.
Oh, the teeth are working.
Are you ready, Bob? Oops, sorry.
Oh, no, where's it? Where's the volume? Oh, bollocks. Oh, there it is, there it is. Here we go, brilliant. Oh, just go to the top. Oh, God, you're too fast. Greg Haylock, yeah, busy man. David Bulsom, John Bruce, Sacramento, Gary Allen, hello. Mike Freeburn, Belfast. Anita Schlecker, Lieber Grüß, Föhringen, Brian, Freue mich dich in Stuttgart und Karlsruhe zu sehen. Wirklich, Grüß Bar, Bell. From Blackburn, Robert Monroe, Tobias Van De Pier, welcome back from the Isles, Brent Shawley, Cramlington, Scott Law, Ballymore, Susie Coxon from Derbyshire, geese a break here, Leslie Swadoba for Holland, Leo Van Oosten from Groningen, Mike Rickards from Orkney, hey, Andy Mayhew, Zoggy Evesham, David McElroy from Dunfermline, Susan Alexander, hello from Vermont, hoping that our cat does not attack the Easter Bunny. Here I am. With a teeth. I went up to the islands. We went up to the islands like on the Saturday morning, right? And I had my phone charger, I had the wallet, I had everything. I sort of spare key for the car, like everyone remember the CalMac ferry tickets, everything, right? I got 20 minutes up the road and I went, oh no, I forgot my teeth. Forgot my teeth. I never thought I would ever say that. I mean, oh my God, I forgot my teeth. And I left my dentures behind, but it didn't matter. It's like I said, I'm not from the Tom Cruise school of vanity. So it's like, I wasn't like, oh no, people can't see me. Don't let them take photographs, please. I was doing interviews and everything without them. I can't be arsed, right? And because they just make me sound worse, right? And it's, hi, darling.
Hi,
did you get the ice cream?
Yeah.
Yes! We have ice cream. Right. Anyway, 13 weeks, no smoking, no drinking. 13. You know that, 13 weeks.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I know. I got a surprise as well. And it's, yeah. And eventually it will be 13 weeks with no ice cream. But where was I? Yeah, teeth. And, So, you know, I went up with Duncan, if you're watching Duncan the Low, it's my twin brother. So I'm up there and I'm doing all the bits up there and Duncan, a neighbour who's a sheep guru, Duncan was there and he was like, I mean, and Duncan's got the same front teeth. We met with, oh, it's my long lost brother. The teeth. And then this, and like I said, I had to do the interviews on Monday. And they were all Zoom interviews and I couldn't be bothered putting in teeth that were obviously false. You know, they were like methadone mixed teeth, right? And they were, I go, hello there, don't I look absolutely stunning, right? And I'm whistling on my way to window, I'm not doing that. So I didn't. And Mick Wall and I had a great laugh, right? For those of you who don't know, Mick and I go back years, right? And Mick and I go back to Mick's first, his first kind of thing with me was, I think it was in 1984, right? It was on Fugazi times, right? And that's when we first met. And Ray Palmer was always the photographer that came along with Mick when we did the shoots. And Ray was there for all loads of visits and tour things and on-road things and stuff, right? And I gotta admit, you know, when I started doing the interviews on Monday, it's like, it's been difficult, right? Because I'm not really, I'm not really into it. I'm talked out, you know. I mean, I got somebody came at me and said, like, they wanted to do an interview for Holland and they wanted to talk about an interview specifically about Kaylee. And I went, no, right? I'm just not, I'm really not into it. It's like, you know, hey, look at the monkey on the organ. I just went, you know, I can't do it. I can't, I'm not very good at doing that kind of stuff, you know. And it was the same on the Monday. It was like, you know, I had to do a couple of interviews. I did an interview with Q Magazine, right? And I can't remember the member's name. I think it was Joshua or something. Jonathan, right? And he was in Virginia. Right? It was great. I finally got an interview with Q Magazine since 1985. And funnily enough, the last interview I'd done with Q Magazine was when Dave Hepworth and Matt were doing it. We'd done the interview with, which was online on the Facebook page, right? And I'm doing this interview with, I think it was Jonathan, and he was a really nice guy, really, really nice guy. And it, like, and he said, like, and he had to go into the Marillion stuff, I mean, because people do, right? And I just go, wall, get in there, get. I kind of heard around, it's the one thing I learned about interviews, it's like, you know, just because somebody asks you a question, you know, it's a bit like being a politician, really. Just because somebody asks you a question, you don't have to answer it. And I always, you know, something I learned years ago, I think, you know, doing interviews is a kind of, you know, people should do masterclasses in them, right? You know, I mean, learning how to do interviews and get things across. So I was taught that years and years ago. Brian Munns, who was my press officer at EMI, and Keith Goodman, my original press officer before pre-EMI, you know, they kind of like guided me and like kind of what to do. It's like, you take command, you know, like, you know, if you're doing like a BBC local station, right, take command. It's like, because if you don't, I mean, like nowadays, if you don't grab it, they will try and talk to you about Kaylee all the time or Lavender. Like, you know, can you tell me about this? Well, I was doing this last week, right? And you have to grab it. And it was the same as Q interview where Jonathan, the Q guy in Virginia. It's like, so like, you know, Fugazi in 2000, no, right, no, we're not doing that. I said, let's next, right? And it was, and when I got Mick, it was like, I was kind of dreading getting Mick because, I mean, Mick and I were doing interviews, like I said, way back. Mick was here in the studio. He did the very, very first ever Kerrang interview I did as a solo artist, right? And we did it. He came up to the studio and he was at the Lockerbie gig. He came down the Lockerbie gig and was a messed up little Viking. He was Lockerbie after the Rec Cinema when we went to the hotel. My God! And you know, Mick's always been around and there was all the stories. He's done everything with me. He was in Berlin. You know, I remember, and Mick and I were talking of this. I said, I remember when you came out of Berlin and I was sitting there In the hotel, I forgot the name of it. And we were sitting in the hotel just round the corner, right? And I was in this really Spartan room. The rooms were really crap, right? I mean, you made a travel lodge, you made it look like a French, a Parisian suite, right? And we were stuck there for months in this cheap hotel, right? Room service, And Mick and I did this interview in the room, and you know, and I said to him, I said, Kaylee's the one. I said, like, this is the biggest album, this is the hit album, this is the one that's going to break it. Mick's going, and he believed me as well. He knew, as I did at that time, I knew it was going to happen. I knew that Kaylee was the hit. And it was like, Mick's been there, and he came all the way through with us to America in 1997, and he was there with the breakup, and he was here, like I said, when I was in the studio. In the rehearsal room with Mickey and things, and like, and it was, so what are you going to do now? And there we were on Monday, going like, you know, hi Mick. And it was scheduled for 2 hours. I mean, it was that, you know, the interview was scheduled for 2 hours. And I'm going, what the fuck are we going to talk about 2 hours? We've done everything. And we got it. And it was a really brilliant interview, as all the interviews were Mick that I've ever done have been. And it was great, and it weaved, and it took a lot of the old stuff and brought it into kind of the current kind of curriculum, and you know, we talked about the tour and, you know, how the tour was, and now it reflected on where I am at the moment and stuff. And it was brilliant. It was absolutely wonderful. And but I mean, it's, you know, the one thing I found is, like, I'm finding it very hard to talk about music. And especially the stuff where it's like, well, what happened? But, you know, I can't be arsed, right? And I know a lot of people really want to hear it, but I have said it so many times. It's like, that's the other reason why I need to get this autobiography written, and go read the book. So I want to read the book, right? Buy the book, read the book, right? And I don't have to do them anymore, right? Why did you do this, right? Where did you get the name? Like, my top 10, right? Top 10 interview things. The number one is, where did you get the name Fish from? I really hate that one. I really hate that one now. Well, so how did you get the name Fish? Right. Oh, it's a genital disorder. I never talk about in public. And it's like, kind of, the other ones, the Gabriel ones. So, like, you know, was P. Gabriel a big influence? Oh, God's sake. Genesis Gabriel. Right. And why did you leave Marillion? Are you ever going back to Marillion? Will there ever be a reunion with Marillion? I even got one the other day. Somebody put something on the Facebook page and said, so I'm really going to be joining you on stage. No. No. Well, yeah, so I was there on Monday, and then it was like, and I navigated my way through Monday. I did really well, and I was really quite, there's something about, you know, it's doing a day of interviews, it's like, it's a challenge. I mean, it's a real kind of, you really feel, you know, once you've done that 7-8 hour shift, you know, you're kind of, you can feel it. You can, your head's been put through the exercise machine, right? And then I was kind of getting all together. When did I go in? I've forgotten, darling, because of the drugs. Was it Tuesday I went in to see Gillian? Was it Wednesday? I can't remember. It's all a blur, right? I had to get my teeth done. And I was like, and I was dreading, and I kind of, it was, normally what I try and do is part of my kind of spectral thing. It's like, I have to think through stuff, right? I have to think through stuff and imagine pain or imagine what's going to happen, and I prepare myself mentally for whatever's going to happen, and that way I deal with it calmly. Yeah, that's how I deal with it. That's my old spectral self is, yeah, and I think about stuff a lot. So, like, you know, the night before I do anything, like, for example, the knee operation, I mean, I think through it all. What could go wrong? You know, what could possibly happen? How I was going to deal with it? And I kind of put everything in place so that kind of, when it does happen, although it's completely different, because obviously, like, you know, your imagination and the reality stuff is completely detached, but, like, it makes me feel better. And then when you get into it, it's not so much of a shock. And I didn't do that. I had to walk away from the dentist bit because it's like, I don't want to think about it. I really don't. I don't want to think about what they're going to, because I knew what was going to happen, right? It's like, you know, the bottom line was, right, they were going to go in, and, like, because I'd had my teeth taken out, it had healed up. So they were going to have to cut my gum open. They were going to have to drill two big holes, right, in the top part of my jaw, right? And hope that they worked, right? So that, you know, when the drill goes in, I hope they worked, right? And I've drilled plaster before, right? And I've seen accidents happen with drills. So they're drilling two big fucking holes in the top of my jaw, right? Then they've got to put raw plugs in, right? And then they've got to put the screws in, right? And, like, there's going to be a lot of blood. And that's why I had to keep it out. I had to go, like, I'm going to drown. I'm going to drown in my own blood. And all this goosh machine works okay. And I couldn't think about it, right? And I had a little extra ice cream that night, right? And it was kind of like, I'm going, fuck. I told Angus, hello, how you doing up in the croft? Angus is working up there tonight. Watch the Red Bulls, don't overdo them. Think of your heart, right? And it's like, I've gone, I don't know. And I went in the morning, and Simona said, I was quiet, right? And Simona knows when I go quiet. It's like, it's a bad, it's, you know, she knows not to talk to me when I go, right? And I was, right? And I barked a little bit in the morning. And then she drove me across to, she drove me across the Trinan to the dentist to see Gillian. And it was great, Gillian's brilliant, right? And I walked in and it was all, hiya, hiya. And I'm going, and I went in and then it was the injections. Five bastard injections, right? Ding, 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 ding. Oh, there, oh, on that bit where you go, oh. And that's why I'm turned into a squirrel, right? I got a squirrel face, right? I came out and I was okay and lucky because I was already on all this painkillers for my knees, right? It wasn't too bad. You right, darling? So I was on tramadols and paracetamol, so like I thought, and I timed my trammies before I went into the dentist, so like I knew I could get them. And the first thing I said to Julie was, I'm already on drugs, right? I'm on tramadols. She went, oh, that's good, right? And it's like, and she goes, paracetamols, you should take. I said, no, I take paracetamols as well, don't worry about that. And then it started, right? And it was like the injections, and I was like, you know that bit? And it's, you know, you went, it's that phrase, this might sting a bit. And you immediately go, your ass cheeks go like that, oh fuck, and then bang, bang, bang. And then I felt nothing, right? I felt nothing as they sliced me open, and then it was like, it was a bit like biting in a dining room table as somebody was drilling somewhere in the table. It was a bit like that, you know. I had that feel that. But it's up all there. And when I got the injection, one of the injections that I got given, I thought it was actually going up my nose. I thought the needle had slipped and it gone inside my nose. And all that bit where they go, well, you open your mouth a little bit wider, you go. Forty-five minutes that was. Right. And I got the jewels, and said, just a little bit more. And I lost count of time. I was, you know what I was doing? I was up on the croft. I went up to the croft. Because I kept my glasses on, I stared at the light and I went to the croft, right? And I can't remember, I think I was putting drainage in or was fencing or something like that. But that's what I was doing. And I was like, and it's like three people with their feet in your mouth doing stuff, right? And then like, and it's just, and there was this horrible sweet taste. I didn't even want to ask what it was. It didn't taste like blood, right? And I'm going, what is that? Right? And of course, and then you get the itchy nose. You always get, and it's hands in your mouth. You try to go, and then it was like, and then it got to the end, and then that just sew me up, right? And I feel like I've got one of those, it's like a little mini roast beef, like a sort of thing you get in a doll's house, you know. There's a little mini roast beef in there, like it's all wrapped up with string, right? And because I couldn't eat hot drinks for 6 hours and stuff, so it was like, you know, kind of, there was all that, don't do this, don't do that, wash with salt water, right? And I was like, but it was okay. And I was like, and to be honest, it's like between the tramadol and the paracetamol and everyone else, and like, I just took care of myself. But the thing was, Gillian said as well, she said, when she drilled, because I told you, I was worried about when it went in, it was like, you know, the whole thing was going to go, you know. And because, it, you know, I, like I said, I stopped smoking 13 weeks ago, or then it was 12 weeks ago. What?
Do you want a half-cold
beer? An
Erdinger?
Half-cold? Yeah, I'll take an Erdinger, that'd be lovely. Thank you, babe. And, where was I? Forgot, non-alcoholic beer just made me go, rabbit. But yeah, so I had the stitches up, and then Gillian said to, like, you know, she said, it's incredible. She said, look, but the way your bones healed. Well, that's Liam.
Good evening. Bob watching. Hello, Bob. Bob in Burnery.
Yeah.
He's there.
Looking pretty suave, isn't he? Man about town. This is the thing about hats. Gentlemen in this house, we've got a thing about hats.
It's only gentlemen in this house.
So anyway, where was I? So anyway, so when Julie went in, she said, like, it's incredible how well your bones healed. She said, you know, normally she said, normally we go in and say they're like mush, right? They're really soft. She said, but yours are like really hard. Looking odd, mate. Odd, it is odd, odd, odd. And I looked like a squirrel, right? Or I was a hamster yesterday, because it was like, because all the injections are And Simone had to shave me because I had she said, I've got to shave you this morning. Because everyone was forward, right? And I looked like a wee puffy thing, wee puffy mouse thing. So it was a... It's yes, it's been a week, but I'm getting better. I said, I've got to wait to, and she said, like, you know, don't put your dentures in for, like, oh, is it 10 days or something? All that. I'm not wearing them anyway. And she said, 10 days, no dentures. And then I get my new teeth in 10 weeks. And I'll either have my Freddie Mercury teeth or my methadone mic teeth or my fish teeth. All that. I got to say now, I didn't know whether to laugh or cry, really. But yeah, so I got this. Somebody knitted me a fish. It's a knitted fish. But I think this is who it's from here.
She put the teeth on it.
She put the teeth on it. It's actually got the teeth on the fish. Right. That's the teeth on the fish. It's been a long time. Please find and close the fish. Story behind it, I became ill a few weeks ago and was bored senseless, and to keep me occupied, I began knitting things. And sort of ended up knitting a fish in Ibs colours. As you do. One day I was just sitting there, next thing I knitted a fish. Complete with detachable teeth, sorry, on the mend now. Thank you for the music, the memories, da da da. The kids, which they became, I can't say that, which they became known as. FWF, Disco Bog, he wears a remote, awesome. Look forward to bringing kids to see you in Aylesbury in Cambridge. Best of wishes to you and Simona on your move to the Croft. Now I leave you, the pastor's had it say. Best wishes, Angela. Angela, thank you very much for the fish. I don't know what I'm going to do with this, but I think I might give it to my mum. I think she'd appreciate this fish. Right? This is a shutter. Oh, hello, Cliff Wren from Brownies Rock. How you doing, mate? Brownies Rock. Yeah, thank you very much for those brownies. They were great. Yeah, Cliff at Brownies Rock. Google them, Brownies Rock. The brownies, they're to die for, right? Literally. Your cholesterol kind of goes through the roof. David pulls a couple of weeks off and he forgets all. I don't, right? What I did forget today was Jim Hayden, because of the Tim Pounder thing, the showboat thing that I put up. I'll sort it out later on, but there is a link where you can actually see that interview. But Tim sent me a link. But Tim is a friend of Jim Hayden, right? And Jim Hayden was a keyboard player that took over from John Young years and years ago. And, I forgot about that as well, right? But Tim says, Tim had contacted me, he said, will you do my podcast? And I went, yeah, I'll do the podcast. Oh, yeah.
Sorry, Bishop, do you want me to?
It's a bit frosty. Get rid? No. We'll deal with that. Like that. So Tim Pounder, sure, but we did the interview, and I was putting a thing up, and I was going, Jim Hayden. I couldn't remember what band Jim Hayden was in. So Vance says, what's it me, Stevie, right? He's like, Steve can't remember who was in the band last year, right? And it was, and I was going, what lineup was you? And I remember Jim Hayden took over from John Young. And John Young had come in as keyboard player. And it was like, and John got, the Scorpions came to John and approached John Young and said, look, will you do this gig, right? And they offered them shitloads of money, right? And John, give me his due, came up to me, unlike a certain bass player from years and years ago called David Payton, who didn't do that, who just slid off into the darkness, right? Well, did slide off into the darkness. Anyway, that's another story. I ain't going into that one here, right? That has been kept. And yeah, it's another thing, right? It's where it all comes in. It's all these circles that happen, right? So it was like... So yeah, so Jim Hayden, like... I said to John Young, find me a keyboard player and you can go with Scorpions. I said, oh yes, all you have to do, find a keyboard player, get him rehearsed in. And Jim came across, and I think it was in Zurich or somewhere like that, in Switzerland. And Jim took over, and he was brilliant, right? John went away at Scorpions, earned a shitload of money, had a great time, right? And Jim Hayden came in, and Jim was brilliant. He was a lovely bloke. A really, really lovely bloke. And he got the name Cabin Boy, because he was so sweet. He was like, oh, Cabin Boy. Ah, Cabin Boy. And a little bald head, Cabin Boy. Cabin Boy, you do that for us. And he was a great keyboard player. And I really wanted him in the band. And I'd said to him, I said, you know, and we got on really well. I mean, like, the two of us just kind of, we just went bing in tune, right? And his wife and him had applied for visas for Australia, to live in Australia, and he just got them accepted at the end of the tour. And he actually said, I've been waiting for years to find a band like this and to get into Bald. And he said, I've been waiting to find a thing like what you've got. And he said, I've just been given the green card for Australia or whatever it is, whatever colour it is. And he said, I've got to go to Australia with my wife, and he did. And I was really sad. And he was like, and we kind of kept in touch. He's a lovely, lovely bloke, cabin boy, Jim Hayden, right? And it was interesting with Tim Pounder. It was like, you know, being the cabin boy. But yeah, we're talking about people who left the band and joined the band. So we're driving back, right? This is absolutely truthful, right? So Simone and I are driving back in the Transit Trail. And we always try and stop off at... we try and make it and get our midpoint for the drive is Speen Bridge. And there's a wee kind of cafe vibe thing. It's like, it's one of them places that's got those shops, right? Where it's always got a sale on. Like 50% off, 12% off, vastly reduced, like da-da-da. Hundreds of stuff, right? Hundreds of stuff. I mean, it's so many clothes. I've never seen, their stock bill must be huge, right? It's just room after room after room. And it's all like, what was the make? Woolens. Remember what was the woolens in Speen Bridge? I kind of went, that's a really good make, a really good woolens. I think they were acrylic. And I was like, going, what? But yeah, but everyone's got sale tags, reduced, 10%, 50%, da da da. And we went in there, and you remember that?
Yeah.
And we thought, well, we were going to go to the cafe. No, we'll just go to the co-op. We'll get some stuff in the co-op. And they had Choco Mel in the co-op, right? Choco Mel. I think it was a co-op, right? Anyway, so the wee spar shop or whatever at Speen Bridge. Choco Mel, little yellow cans of doom, right? It's chocolate milk, right? Choco Mel, and it's from Holland, and it is brilliant, right? And they had tiny little cans that were about £2 or something like that, and I went, oh, ooh. I had the three of them on the way down. I was just driving down the road, and it was like, every now and again, shake one up, right? They're brilliant. Choco Mel. I found that when I found that in Holland, it was like a whole new world, right? And needless to say, in certain states of mind, right, this chocolate milk is like, it's like from heaven, right? It is from heaven. When it's frozen and you're in that state of mind, it's heaven. Choco Mel, right? And with brandy, it's even better. You put a bunch of brandy in a choco milk and sweet, it's like, bang, bang, double hit, man, bow, bow. Right. Anyway, so we go in, we find the choco milk. I'm going like, wow, this is brilliant. Come round the corner, go to the till, and all I hear is, hang up, Bush, how you do it? And he went, man. And it was Dermot McLennan, right? And Dermot was our sound engineer in the Muppets, in the Muppets tour. Or he was in the Muppets crew. Right, with Dermot and Stuart and stuff, and like Gonzo and everybody, and like, and he was like, it was Dermot, right? And I hadn't seen Dermot for years, and there we were, in Speen Bridge, in Choco Mel Heaven. And I'm going, Dermot, right, blah blah. And it turns out he was working for Elton John, like, you know, in all the places and all the world, right? There's Dermot, right? And he was taking his son. He lives seemingly down in the Midlands now, in England, right? And I can't remember what it was, Burton and Trent or something like that. And he was taking his kid, and he said, "Like, I've got a kid now." It's like, he had a kid at 50, and he's like going, "Wow, wow." And he's going up because they had a yacht up in what was it? No, Glensheath, up at Kintail, right? And he had a yacht on the other side of the lock up at Kintail. You weren't for Elton John, yeah, that's what happens. You get a lot of work for me. Work for Elton John, you get a yacht. Work for me, you get a small matchbox thing with a sail in it. And he was going up to go, he'd take his kid up to on the yacht in Kintail. And we're standing outside the spar shop going like, bah, I'm talking about. And he said, like, you know, remember, you know, when he was kind of not doing much for that, but we found him, and we were a stepping stone to Dermot going on to great things, and it was lovely. And it's a great feeling when you meet guys like that, like some of your crew guys and things, or even and musos as well, that go on to do great things. Like you've just been like a little stepping block that's just gotten them up into like a spotlight, and then they've taken the jump forward. It's a lovely feeling, right, to have that, right? And Dermot was one of those guys. And it was funny because as Dermot said, he said, yeah, he said, Elton John. He said, I was at the Elton John party, he was there. And sure enough, who was there but David Payton, the bass player, right? And he said, I'll never forget that story. He said, I'll never forget. He said, that story, he said, no, I know what it means to you. He said to me, he said, I know what it means to you. And it was completely different. And David, he thinks David remembers it as well. Good. Right. But it was really weird, you know, Speen Bridge, middle of nowhere, on the way back, driving the transit van, in the middle of the Highlands, to meet a sound engineer that I knew for ages and ages and ages. A song. What the hell did I put in? Right, oh yeah, I'd played this for ages. And I thought, I'll play this. Bing, 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 bing. I put it out. I saw it and said, not as bad as I thought. So I play this because I've not played it for a while. And well. I was gonna play an Easter song but I'd forgotten to write one. Happy Easter. Angus, this is for you. Jump about.
Please let me introduce myself. I'm simply a man of our time. Confused and bewildered, I seem to live without reason or mind. Betrayed by a system, I give
Weltschmerz. From the album Weltschmerz. 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 It's going to be great. We never played it in Europe before. So we'll be going out into Europe and playing that song for the very, very first time. Because as you probably expected, that is going to be on one of the set lists. Oh, it's going to be a song. They'll be popping in and out of the set list probably. Yeah, popping in and out. Yeah, Germany. Football coming up. That could be us. The football is like, you know, 4-0 by Holland. Jesus God. And then 1-0 by Northern Ireland. Great goal, by the way. People going, you go to Germany? Nah. I watch on the telly. I've got too much on. The Croft is taking on a whole, it's a complete thing. It's amazing. I mean, it's, we went up there. We went up there a week past Saturday. And we loaded up the transit. It was great. And thanks to my mate, Gary. Gary, hello. Yeah. And Gary helped us strap up. Gary, I know how to work the straps now. Strapped up all the stuff in the back of the van. And there was the wood burning stove and all the bits for the shower and a new basin and the toilet seat and stuff. And then there was all the other gear we took up. Got my post thumper and everyone. And we drove up and it was great. And it's the first time, it's the first time, believe it or not, that was the first time I'd driven a transit on any kind of huge trek, right? I mean, I'm pure rock and roll, I am, right? And I've never driven I've driven a covered van back in the oldies in 82. But I mean, that was a 6-hour stretch in the transit, and it was great. I loved it. And I was really, really happy with it all. And we got the ferry and got up to the place. Bob and Iris, hello. It was great seeing everybody up there again. And it was just, you know, Keith and Sheena. It's funny because we've got so many friends up there now, and I really miss the place. And the house is just, the White House is really coming together. And it was exciting to walk into it. And what Angus has done is just amazing. It's like one man band. And you know, as I said, he's a wee ninja. He was up on the roof in a 60 mile an hour gale. He actually got blown off the roof one time, right? And it was he's just been doing it all on his own. And to walk into it and see the extension and everything that's been done, and then sensing that this is our home, it was a really lovely feeling. And it was really exciting. And we were up there, it wasn't a great, weather-wise, it wasn't a good week at all. It wasn't a good week. But, you know, bad to mind it, it's like, one of the days, you're probably, people going like, what is this, Frank? Is that a misspelling, you know, in the introduction? Like, what, you took down a sheep, Frank. A sheep Frank, right? Frank, F-A-N-K, right? It's basically a bunch of fencing and set up in a way that allows you to move sheep. And so basically you take a bunch of sheep and you move them into a fank, and it allows you to split them up and take five there and three. If you're working with them, if you're doing shearing, if you're cleaning their feet, you know, if you're giving them injections or examining them, or if it's lambing, or if you split them up for whatever, right? You bring them in, and they're like little pens that are all joined on, that have got runnels through. And they're designed in a way that you can manage them a lot better. So that, and it was a really ancient Frank, right? And the thing was that all the grass, because the fence had been used, it was like that kind of square fence, it was like little squares. And the grass had grown up through it and had tied it down to the soil. So I was dealing with all these really old rotten fence posts and pulling up all this stuff out of the ground. And the wind was howling over the top of me, and it was pouring rain. And I was just concentrating on what I was doing, you know. And it was great just to... I'm loving it. It's great to do something physical, and it is so spiritual in just doing something. And while I was pulling out the fence from the ground, there were worms, right? And so probably going, some of you look at me going like, you guy go nuts, man. Worms are a good sign. They're a great sign of soil, good soil. And the thing is, the soil up there is very sandy, and it's an alkaline kind of soil because there's a lot of shells and stuff in the sand, right? And and the kind of organic matter is kind of, it's quite a thin layer, right? It's quite a thin layer. And I was finding worms when I was ripping the frank out. And because the frank was where a lot of sheep had been for years and years and years, so they'd ran through it, they'd all shit there and stuff. So it's like, I just went, ah, that's where the garden goes. And I was sitting there in the wind and the howling rain, and I'm going like, yeah, I was working out where to put fruit trees and how to put arrays, what to do and how to run things and stuff, you know. And it was a wonderful feeling. And you know, I'm in there, I mean, you know, it was wind, it was rain, it was great, and I'm sitting there and I've got my hood on, I can hear the rain pelting off my hood, and I've got all the wire all stacked up and the ground's all clear and da-da-da, right? And you know, I was not thinking about talking to anybody about what Fugazi was about. I was just there, right, in my place, right? And it was just a wonderful feeling. And you know, when we're going up now, it was like we sorted out, we got the bin shed dug as well at the front. So Gary was up operating the wee 5-ton JCB. And Simona was driving the little 3-tonner as well, dumping the spoils and things. So we're levelling up some areas and things. But we're putting a bin shed in the front. And we're going to put a bin shed in the front because we're on the beach and you get a lot of people come down the beach, in the summer especially, right? Which is why we've got to put the canopy up. But what happens is that, you know, if you leave your bins at the front, right at the very front, everybody that comes along takes the dog shit and puts the dog shit in your bin, and they put all their stuff in your bin, right? And your bin just goes, right? And so you get, everybody say, like, you got to bring your bins in. So you put a big sign up saying, like, our bins, private bins, go to the harbour, right? Take your bags to the harbour, right? So, and we got, and because of the winds as well, because it was, like I said, it was 70-mile-an-hour winds when we were up there one night. And most of the time during the day, it was gusting 40 mile an hour, you know, up to 50s and things. Which I remember when Wes Death was going, like, he said, man, like in Florida, it's 50 mile an hour winds here, man. Like, and I'm going, 50 mile an hour? Fourth Road Bridge is still open. It was the same day. I was like, I was going to post this. I thought, oh, nah, I'm not going to do that, right? And they would say, like, ferries cancelled in Dover. And I'm going, yeah, I know where you're at. And it was like 70 mile an hour winds in Essex and stuff. And you're going like, yeah, people are going, you're moving to the Outer Hebrides. The weather must be shite up there. Global warming, welcome. So it was. You know, we've got to get the bins in, because, I mean, the bins get blown about. You've got to tie them up. So we build this whole thing, and we're getting it all set up. It's my spectral thing taking over. People were asking me about the studio and the garden and stuff, and I've been saying, I'm full. I'm full here. I don't know what else to do, right? Everything's done. The garden is done. I don't know what else I can do, really, in that garden that's in my nature for me to do. You know, I like building things and doing projects and stuff, right? And it was great clearing out, well, John will clear out the Peter Pan pond the other day. So, like, Peter Pan's up and running again. But, I mean, but here, you know, it's, I don't know what that is. Again, this was one of the things I was talking to Mick Wall about. And I said, you know, like, since Mick was up here in 1988, 89, it was like, you know, we're in a situation where, you know, I'm out. I don't know what else to do, but up there, on Bernary, right, on the Croft, like, it's like a massive blank page, right? And it's like, you know, there's so many things you can do and put together. And you've got no idea. You've got no idea how much that appeals to me. Like, how much me. It's like, build, create. I love this shit. And while I was taking down the fact, and I was talking to Duncan, my neighbour, and he came up and I was talking to him and his wife Kathleen. We were talking about the pastures and how we were going to set the pastures up and things, you know. And I was saying, like, you know, this is the idea, and like, I want to try and maybe get another shed and put a fank in there. And I'm getting really in it, going, like, yeah, if we bring that material. And he's going, sounds good. Sounds good. And yeah, it's exciting. And it's, and Simona was. You know, the two of us were kicking around in all the wind. And of course, now we're moving into that area now where it's like kitchen stuff. The kitchen's becoming real now. And now we're talking about where shelves go and things. It's like, oh, it's brilliant. I've been playing this for a while. So, A song for... So many meanings. Boomski! Sea song from Belchmerz. Angus, how you doing? You still at the Croft? Well, that's good light there. Let me tell you about sheep. Right. I got my Blue Peter sheep badge. Right. My Boy Scout sheep badge. I got my sheep badge anyway. Right. So we were up there. And Bob and I, hi Bob. Right. We were up there round about this area that we call Rivendell, also called known as Quad Bridge. Right. And Quad Bridge is where Duncan takes his quad over. But it's also, that's where the back alley is, right? There's the back track between Bob and Iris's house and our house. So rather than walk all the way around the beach, right, all the way around down to the beach and all the way along the front road and all the way around, Bob and Iris, if we want to see each other, we've got a little back way. We back Venno, right? By Tara Loch. That's true, it's called Tara Loch. So just by the banks of Tara Loch, down for Quad Bridge in Rivendell, nearby the big strainer with the bog, right? That's where I said to Bob, we really need to put in a little kind of corner thing, styly vibe platform. So the strainer sits there, and round about it's just a mishmash of bog, right? And it's where all the drains go down to Rivendell and underneath Quad Bridge, right? I said to Bob, we need to build something, and Bob and I are thinking, oh, hi, Bob, we put a big thing. I said, let's go up and have a look at it. So we went up to have a look at where we were going to put this wee platform in so that Iris and Simona can walk around and see each other and things. And as we walked up, there was a little white thing, it was obviously a sheep, that was parked next to the strainer. And we're getting closer, and I saw the marking, saw the colours on it, and I knew I saw it was one of Duncan's sheep. And we're getting closer, and I could see it. At first I thought it might have been dead, right? Because, like, sheep are born to die, right? It's like, Duncan told me this. He said, like, you know, he said, like, if you're going to look after sheep, he's like, you need, you know, a short memory and a stave and a spade, right? And I thought, oh, I hope it's not a dead one. And I saw the head move and went, oh, that's all right. And it didn't get up and move. And I thought, well, maybe it's just comfortable with our presence, right? And it wasn't very comfortable at all, right? Because what we found as we got closer, it was stuck in the bog, right? All four legs right in there, right? Couldn't move. It was absolutely rammed solid, right? And it was like, and it'd obviously been there for a while because there was a great big pile of shite out the back of it, right? And, what?
Nothing.
His wife goes, don't go into too much detail, right? But there was a mound, right, at the back. So we knew it'd been there for a while, right? And I'm going, this thing must have been starving and had a real drouth on. It must have been really thirsty. And Bob and I are looking, we'll have to get this out. And but where it was, it's like basically you had this big strainer and the sheep was right next to the strainer. But on the other side of the sheep, it was like you put your foot in there, you went down 3-4 feet. I mean, I've been in there, right? It's not nice. So I had to try and find a way around. So we got around the back and I'm trying to pull the sheep out, but the sheep hadn't been sheared. So we've got other words today. The sheep hadn't been sheared, right? And so every time I was pulling it, with big lumps of wool were coming out. Oh, jeez, I'm throwing about. And I could not move the back legs. And I went around the front and it's like, you know, and I got my hands under and I took my watch off, I took the jacket off and like, then I'm in there and like, and I eventually got the front two legs up and I thought if I could get the front two up and then we can get a hound in the back, we can put, no way. So I said, but we need to get our strap. So Bob went back to the Nissen hut because he'd brought a strap up where we'd pulled out the vehicle, that's another story, the day before. So he came back with the strap, and I went, oh, we're going to have to get the strap underneath the sheep. So I was like, so I had to get down on my new two knees, right? And they say, do not kneel, right? I've got to get this done. So I'm down on my two knees, arms off, watches off, and I'm down, and I had to put my hand right under the sheep's belly in the bog, and it was uncannily warm, right? It was really weird. It was a really I've never had that feeling before, where you actually put your hand into like warm mud and wool and stuff with a strap on. Anyway, we got the strap on underneath, right? And I went around and managed to pull it out. And Bob took one end and I got the other, and we both stood on the driest ground we could find, and we tried to lift it up by the back. And we moved, God, it was really straining. And we got the back kind of out and then moved to the front. And we were also very aware it was a ewe, right? And it's lambing season. So it was, we thought, most of the sheep up there, I mean, nearly all the sheep are pregnant, nearly everything. So we knew it was pregnant, right? So we couldn't like put the strap right under the belly. So we moved it up to the front. And eventually this thing went and it came out of the bog. And it couldn't walk, it just fell straight on its back, on its side. And it's the two, kind of, I can't remember what they're called. Is it fetlocks or whatever? But basically it's like the little ankle joints. And the back, we couldn't move them, right? And it tried to get up and it fell over, and trying to get up and fell over. And I said to Bob, went back to try and get hold of Duncan, who was our neighbour, who's got, it was her sheep. And we texted him and said, like, we've got this one. I said, it's still alive, but we don't know what to do with it. And Bob went off, and I was sitting there, and I'm like, and I managed to get it up, and I tried to lift up its four legs and trying to hold it up, and maneuver it across to where there was some grass, like some decent green stuff, and as soon as it hit the grass, it was like, stood with the side of the fence, trying to eat through the bottom of the fence. Don't do that, you'll damage your teeth. You don't know what's going to happen. That goes right. So it was like. So anyway, I was lying on its side, and the feet were like that, and it couldn't move, and I figured it must be like, just the fact it had been in the mud for like a couple of days, that it's just, you know, the muscles just, you know, wasted, right? And I was lying there in the wind and just massaging the sheep's feet, like looking it in its eyes and talking away and stuff. It was brilliant, it was great. And then it was like, you know, Matt tried to get up again, and it moved away again a wee bit, and it got to another bit where there was even more grass. And it was kind of standing up for a bit longer, and then I thought, I'll just leave it, I'll just give it peace, right? And then Duncan came up with the quad, and came over the quad bridge. And it was like, and he said, ah, it'll be all right tomorrow. He said, he'll take it away. And he said, do you want a hand? He said, oh, I'll do it. He picks up this whole thing on his own, up a strong bugger. Picks it up, puts it back in the quad. See, don't worry, it'll be all right. And I felt so proud, right? And I really felt like I'd got a bit of a badge. I got a ticket for that, you know, because it would have been so easy. I think, you know, the old me, you know, a me from maybe 10, 15 years ago would have gone, oh, I better phone somebody up, you know, and it was like, no, you got to deal with it, you know, and you had to deal with it. You kind of yourself were with Bob, you know, Bob and I had to deal with it. I mean, if Bob hadn't been there, I don't think I could have done it myself, you know, but it was So thank you, Bob, for making that moment and contributing to that moment. But it was like, you know, it was just, like I said, when Bob had gone away and I was just sitting there, it was just me and the sheep, and I'm looking in the sheep's eyes and going, yeah, you're going to be all right, son. You're going to be all right, you know. And just massaging, trying to get the feet working again, you know. But it was covered in mud all underneath. And I said to Duncan, I said, you better bring up some shears and cut all this stuff off, cut it, because it's carrying a bit, you know. It was carrying about another 3 or 4 stone in peat mud, right? But it went, but it was so, you know, and I went back and I was really chuffed. And, you know, people do that up there all the time, you know. And, you know, and I mentioned it to Ashley and stuff, and then Keith, and it was, oh, boy, well, you know, it's been 2 or 3 of them happened a day. Like, I went, oh, yeah, it was my first. It was my first. And it was like, and it was special. And it was really, and the thing that made it even more special was that Duncan said, aye, he said, it's carrying twins. And I went, yeah, that was cool. That was really cool. And that was kind of, it made it for me, you know what I mean? It was like really doing something, you know? And it's part of the whole magic of being up there, you know? The creation and stuff. And it is interesting because it was, you know, I was talking again when I was doing the interviews. I said, yeah. I said, so we finished the European tour and we go up in November, and that's when our Magic 13, all right? Who are coming back from their holidays in the Black Isle next month. Yeah. That's when they go to the top, they go to the Ram, and they'll all be hopefully impregnated, and as Duncan calls it, they'll all be full, right? And then when we come back off the British tour, off the UK tour, in mid-March, we'll be prepping and getting ready for the lambing season, because the lambing season happens up there in April. So that's going to be wild. So I'm going to be on a tour bus, right? Talking to Duncan about the sheep and wondering how the sheep are getting on and things, and, you know, and prepping and getting ready. And Duncan, it was great when we were up there as cattle. They all calved spectacularly well. And it was just wonderful being around all that, you know, just being there. And like I said, we just can't wait to get up again, you know. And so I think I should play another song, you know. I'm used to watching Angus, yeah. Angus knows all about this. But yeah, but it's a whole world. It's a different world. And, you know, coming back here, it's like really strange coming back. I mean, I love this place. It's great. It's a great place. But I mean, at the same time, like every time we go up there now, it's harder to leave, you know, and the balance is changing, you know, where that is home and this is kind of the other place now, you know, and it's swirling about. Well, let me go and find you something. Watch out! Oh, I know what. I've been listening to some of the. I've got to listen to the four CDs that are on the. The four CDs that are going to be on the Eternal Exile. CD3, yes. Oops, picked up the wrong note there. Yeah, so this is CD3, because on Eternal Exile there's four CDs in the there's four CDs and a Blu-ray in the whole thing. And and it was strange because we were watching one of the things we got the TV in because we're through in that room when my mum was living here. We got a TV through there, and it's got kind of a lot of Freeview stuff on it, and what we often find at night is that you know we'll go through maybe there about 11 or like half 11 or something, right? And we'll just watch a bit on the TV. I mean, to be honest, we watch a lot of BBC Alba, right? And but the other night it was like we put it on, and it was the thing about the miners' strike, and. And I was talking to some people about that recently, and it made me think, and I thought, well, I'll play this one tonight, because it was quite a relevant thing. And very emotive subject, as you can imagine up here, and in the North England. And so I thought, I'll play this. And this is especially for Angus, right? Because Angus is a Salt Lake chap, and he has been doing absolute wonders up there as our builder and putting our house together, and he's so dedicated. You know, my hat is completely off him. He's just incredible what he does and how he goes about it. And it's great having him on board with us. So this, Angus, is for you, if it's the right one, I think.
Round.
from the Eternal Exile remaster, and that was the one that... I must remember I played that one tonight as well, because I never played that the last time, because I thought Callum had missed it off the disc, but it was my fault. My fault. But yeah, it's as John Watson said, it's like that. Lucky at Glasgow. I mean, well, it's a certain one of the nights at least, right? But yeah, it's... It's really funny, this tour. I'm really looking forward to it. And it's going to be such an amazing celebration. Right? I mean, it's like, because every gig we do takes me... I mean, it is the Road to the Isles, you know? And it's... it is the Road to the Isles, and every gig we do takes us closer. And you know, those songs are going to be following me up there, which is kind of cool. I've got to get this. Bear with me a minute. I should have got it. I'll get it after. What was I going to tell you? Oh, Dana Boyd's for tea tonight.
Wraps?
We are having wraps.
Yeah,
but I bought... Come on, Silly, you just said hello, Renzen. Because Liam's here, you just said hello.
Hello, good evening.
You're in the darkness a little bit. Yeah, oh, no, you're okay.
Doesn't matter, I like to be in the darkness.
That sounded really creepy, actually.
So, no, I'm making wraps because Liam has one or two friends here. I thought it would be easy, and just in case, I bought some, what's it called, Pratatyke? Puff pastry for you, so I can make you something a bit different.
What? Puff pastry?
Puff pastry and with all the stuff I've got here.
Yeah. But see, you get excited with the croft there.
Oh, yeah.
I should put a bit more light on you, you know.
No.
Yeah, and what are we doing tomorrow morning?
Yes, we're going to IKEA. That's the exciting bit now. I can choose a kitchen, I can choose decorations, I can choose wall colors and everything. Thanks to Angus. He's so good, he's so quick and so fast and so, yeah, he gives all his time and heart for us.
Yeah. It's gonna be good though. It's gonna be good. But yeah, it's yeah. Yeah, all happening. And like I said, we're getting the floor and all sort of. It's because it's like, and honestly, the thing was with the space, wasn't it? It was like we went up there and we kind of, the White House has kind of got a design to it, right? I've got to watch what I'm saying here. It's like, the White House has got a design to it. So, rather than being a two up, two down, and it's a one and a half up.
I can explain why.
Yeah, it's looking at. It's rather than being a two up, two down, it's a one and a half up, two down, right? And the kitchen extension at the back, the wall's been knocked through. So what you've got is a big long floor on the one down. And the other one down, right, the other bottom thing is a kind of, it's a spare bedroom, but it's also been wired up. And we're putting wires through from the main floor all the way through to the spare bedroom. Because the spare bedroom is going to become a little mini writing room for doing songs. Because I thought, you know, it might not be fish, but I mean, you know, I think there's always going to be a need for a kind of like a kind of control room. Every house should have a control room. And it means that, like, you know, if I'm doing anything like this, if I want to do Zoom conversations, if I want to do any studio stuff to do with conferences or anything like that, then I've got a specific place. And there we are again, another one of those words, specific place, right, to actually do that. But we also have a place to do music, and that was one of the things I thought ahead, part of my spectral shit, right, was I thought ahead, it's like, you know, in 2 years' time, 3 years' time, you know, I might be in a working with some young people up there or like, you know, Steve and I putting something together that's not necessarily what we've ever done up to now. And it might be, I mean, anything I do from now on will be a complete reinvention of where I'm at now, complete, right? And maybe a more straightforward singer-songwriter thing, and like, you know, I might do that. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to get inspired by a lot of stuff up there. I think in music as well. And that's what we did. So what we're doing is, what I've done on my side is, I've kind of built a studio. Not a studio. It's not a studio, but it's put it this way, Callum Malcolm's going to love it, because what you've got is the downstairs room, which is the control room, and then there's a toilet between that and the restaurant area, the cafe area, where it's Simona's domain, right? But at night, if we want to, we've got the whole cafe, and we could put a drum kit in the kitchen, right? And the mezzanine floor upstairs, which is where my office is, and where the Croft office is, and where I'm kind of looking as being my main writing area for, like, you know, tippy-tappy writing, right? That's also a place that could be used as a recording space. And that's what the White House is becoming. It's becoming a massive, well, it's a massive, it's becoming a real creative hub. And the house that Simona and I are going to be living in is behind that. But that's where the restaurant, the cafe is. And when we did the, I mean, you can explain as well about how it works.
No, huh? I don't know why, what?
Yeah.
No.
But it's like, you know, but the cafe's like, you know, we'd be worried about kind of what we were going to do, all the paintings and posters and everything that we've got. And we went up there this time, and we hadn't seen it. We hadn't really embraced how big the space was. And the actual, as I said, it's a two up, two down. That's now a one and a half up, two down. And that half that goes up above the one down, it's got a massive wall space on it.
It's not massive. It's not.
It's big enough for the Queen poster.
It sounds now. It's big. It's massive. It's not. It's just enough wall space. We thought it would be less smaller. Yeah. A lot less wall space.
Yeah, but coming from here, from this studio, because being in the studio is like it's been really hard.
Yeah.
It's been really hard. You can't find any wall space here at all.
That's why we have. Yeah.
That's why we had so many pictures up in the attic. It was because we just, and when somebody went, here's a picture, here's a frame for picture, you go, oh no, no. Because there was nowhere to put them, because the walls were either covered in insulation, and like in sound insulation, acoustic insulation, and you couldn't nail things on it, right? But up there, there's actually big spaces where we can put a lot of posters and things, and that's what's going to be part of the cafe. So like the cafe is going to be, you know, I've joked before about it, it's going to become a little prog rock cafe up there, you know, but it's only two tables. You have to book a year in advance. That's what the White House is going to be. It's kind of Bastata, and that's what it's called, Bastata, and which is an old Nordic word. It means homestead, right? And that's what it's going to be. It's going to be a real creative space. You talk.
I was just thinking, it's two tables, but it's for 10 people or so, 10 or 12, well, to sit down and have a meal.
Yeah.
So the only thing is people just have to become friends because they have to share the tables.
Yeah. But we've got the outside as well. I mean, you know, it's like, in the summer, it's beautiful up there. And if we get everything going that we want to get going, we're creating an outside area that we can, like a cap area and stuff. And that's what we want to do. And it's like, and then the growing space, like I said, I mean, getting rid of that sheep bank and discovering just where I can actually really put the garden. Because I had my eye on that place for the last year. And I wasn't sure what was there and what I really could do there. And in the steading, and now it's like, you know, yeah, let's grow stuff. Right. And it's going to be cool, but it's going to be interesting. But like I said, it's not like Hannington. I mean, like, you know, for us to get up there, it's 6 hours in the van and an hour and a half ferry and another half an hour on the other side. So it's but it's really quite funny. You can't get away from it. It was like last week when I was up. I was like walking down. I was walking up to work with Gary on the bin store. He was taking the JCB and digging out the big stuff. And I saw this van, right? And it was parked on the beach, right? And it was, this was about 10 o'clock in the morning, right? And it was blowing a hoolie, right? And I was walking up to where we were staying, right? Oh, Barry and Duncan. Hiya, thank you. Thank you. And we stayed at Barry and Duncan's Black House, which is a great wee place. And I walked up from there, which was about, still about half a mile, three quarter mile up to her place. I saw this white van, and my radar went off with that, and I went, punter. I knew. And I saw the guy walking towards me, and he was walking towards his van, and then he took the beeline towards me, and I went, oh, here we go, right? And it was a really nice guy. So I went to see, hello, John Campbell, I think your name was, right? And John was from Inverness, and he's got relatives down on the US, and he popped down, and he knew we were on Bernary, and he knew I was up there. And he came in, and it was really weird. It's like, good morning, how you doing? He goes, how's your knees? Well, grand, thank you. Right. I said, John, thank you. I'm busy working here. Because we were really in the middle of getting it sorted out. So, John, if you're watching tonight, hi, because he said, I watch Fishing Friday, so nice to meet you, John. Right. But it was like, but it was really fun. But we know that's what's going to happen up there. But like, as long as everybody understands, like, up there, I'm Derek. Right? It's Derek up there. Right. So, yeah. What would you like to hear? Is there anything you like to hear? The one I was going to play. This was the one that I was going to play the other day, right? And I think I played the Excel version, but this is the one that Callum's just sorted out. So this is Callum's re-recording, the remix, right? So this is the remix from the 95 Yin Yang sessions that Callum has done, and he's re-queued, and he set me this one up. And I think it's this one. This is lovely. Again, this is with Sam Brown. Is it one? Yeah. This is lovely. Yeah. Favourite Stranger. That was the 1995 recording that's been completely remixed by Callum Malcolm, and it is absolutely stunning. And Sam Brown sounds incredible on it. Still not heard anything back from her. It's like I've been trying to contact. I have to up the ante, I think, a little bit. But yeah, Sam sounds absolutely brilliant on that. And yeah, the voices work really well together. And Dave Payton's bass, beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And of course, what do you say, Frank Usher's guitar work? It's really cool, really nice. It's one of those songs, isn't it? Like, that was really nice, that was. Joe Rosenthal. Joe, yeah, I'm sorry, I got your message, mate. I'm sorry, we've been overrun. I've just managed to get back to you. But it says, I seem to recall having a few beers in the patio at Atlas in Toronto. Well, maybe not be able to sell the vodka and Jaeger by Sir Joel. I remember I had to be on the bar at the Atlas for you in Toronto. Fit like Loon, Ian Barron. Hello, Ian. Yeah, a few with David Dean. Yeah, it's just, yeah, we'll see how it goes. I mean, it's strange, it's like, I was saying, like, you know, the Donald, where's your trousers? I was, what was it? The wind blows low, the wind blows high, the wind blows low, through the streets of the Kilt Dunco, all the lads say, hello, Donald, where's your trousers? It's Gary Innes. It's every time we go up the road, Gary Innes comes on BBC Radio Scotland. I love Gary. I've got to meet him. He's just really funny guy. He's so sweet. He's a really funny guy. And he plays some really captain music. There's some really nice music in there. And stuff that I've the Mucking of Geordie's Byer and stuff like that. I've not heard for years. And it's a really kind of like ancient. It's just the mill mix of stuff that's on it. You mean from kind of reels and jigs and kind of, you know, pipe bands and accordion bands and, you know, things I haven't heard for years. And every now and again you get these amazing kind of singer-songwriters that come out. And you like that, don't you? Darren? Yeah. The Gary Innes show. You know that show we always hear on BBC Scotland when we go up? The Donald, where's your trousers? That Scottish show.
Oh, yeah.
It's great. It's brilliant. And it always happens. Every time we go to Sky in it, it's like, it seems to be every night we're either coming out or going into Sky. It's like that. Hello, it's Gary Innes here on BBC Radio Scotland. You know? And it's great because it's like all the people from Toronto and everywhere. It's like, there's all this kind of, you know, hi, Manny Morag, who's listening to Perth, Western Australia, and so-and-so from Vancouver, and things like that. And it kind of reminds you, kind of, you know, how spread out we are. You know? And it was, you know, even on the island, it's like we're very aware that the people that used to own our house, it's like way back in the kind of in about 1870, you know, they went away to Canada and they went to Nova Scotia, New Scotland, and they went to an area called it was Cape Breton, and so many Scots went there. As I mentioned, it was like. You know, when Simone and I went up there the very first time we were in Harris, and just outside Leverborough, we were filming for Funny Farm Kitchen Garden, and we were driving up towards Liskintyre, which is an incredibly awesome piece of landscape, right? I mean, and it was we were driving up and. So when I was filming out the window, because we were driving by, it was an area, and it was kind of like a salt marsh, and there was kind of a lot of wildlife, and then it kind of opened up and went. It was a lovely piece of filming. I said, "Be sure you get that." And she was filming out the window, and she said, "Like, you need to stop. You need to go to the toilet." And I'm like, "Okay." Right? So we drove all the way up, right, and we were kind of, and we got to the end of it just as it opened out into like the one of the main waterfalls. And then you realise that you hadn't pressed the button, you pressed the button on and off, mm-hmm. and we hadn't recorded it. And I said, we have to get the shot. So we decided to go all the way back. And when we'd been driving up, I noticed that there was a sign that said, like, you know, toilets and cafe, right? And we thought, we'll go in there. And I can't remember the name of the place. And it was, escapes me. But anyway, we popped into this place. In fact, You know, where's the you know, have you got the Bernary book? No, no, the, not the big book, but I know you know, the family book.
I did it before, a while ago. You said this before, a while ago.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, but it ties in with what I'm on about. So we went into this place, and it was, I was amazed that all the books, it was all families, and it was all about family trees and the genealogy of the islands. And I can't, I'm ashamed, because I've just gone into this, so I should have maybe checked it, researched it a bit. But I went in and so it was a map of the United States or a map in North America, right? And they had all these coloured pins for all the families that were like there and places where the new families had gone. And it was astounding, right? And it was just a mass of pinheads, right? All over that whole area around about, you know, kind of Canada, right across into Quebec and then down into the northern part, northeast part of America and beyond, right? And it blew me away that these were all people that had left from the highlands and islands. And this was just North America. And we bought a book there which was pertinent to just the island of Bernary. And that was where we started to look into, you know, who stayed in the house that we got and the people round about. And it's something I'm going to be looking at, taking a lot more interest in when we get up there. But like I said, it was the movement of people was astounding. And I was thinking about this song, and it was an article that got me thinking about today. It was like, I was down at the local hospital. Well, I say the local hospital. It was, I was down at the Eddington, which is a small kind of, what you would call it, I suppose, that would be a village hospital kind of vibe, like a surgery. And it's down in North Berwick, and there's another one at Belhaven, near Dunbar. And my dad was in there for respite when he was taken really ill, and my mum was really struggling looking after him, and my dad went in there for about a week or so. And they had, there was about 12 beds in there. And it's a lovely little place. I think it came from after the war. And I've got a thing flashed up for the East Lothian Courier today, and it said that the council's decided that they're shutting down the beds in that unit. And I think it's 12 beds at the Eddington. And I think there's about 8 in the one at Belhaven. And like I said, I'm flying by the seat of my pants here. And it was... And just recently, you know, we've been dealing with my mum down in Harrington. And the place where she stays is Hilton Lodge. And it's a lovely care home. It's a wonderful care home because it deals with 20 residents and the staff are incredible. And they're really caring and they're special. And we got told just a couple of weeks ago that the Hilton Lodge has been bought by somebody. And they're now going to be moving all the staff and all the residents up to this new place up in on the edge of Addington. And it's a three-story. The guy who's bought it, he actually called it a monstrosity when we had a meeting down at Hilton Lodge, and he was introducing himself to the residents and the residents' family, right? And he actually called the place a monstrosity and laughed, right? And obviously countered himself later on. And but it's a three-story thing, and he said it's got beautiful views out to the Lammermuirs. It's got beautiful views across the Lammermuirs, across about a couple of thousand, you know, box houses that have been put in there in the last 10 years. And they're closing this wee Hilton Lodge place down, which is a lovely Georgian building in the centre of Harrington, and it's been going to be sold, and we obviously all know what it's going to be sold for. And they're moving all the residents and the staff, which has been, and it's a home that's like prided itself on getting the highest marks you can get for a care home, right? And it's getting shut down and they're moving everybody off. And they're moving the people, and like they shut down the 12 beds down in Alberic and 8 beds or whatever across in Millhaven. And the council have decided that they can no longer run it, right? And but the price on the beds in this new place, this new three-story monstrosity, the new care home, right? Yeah. Because I should actually say the Hilton Lodge is a nursing home, and my mother's been moved to a care home, right? And the asking price for people coming in is £2,200 a week, right? £2,200 a week, right? And you're kind of looking at the Eddington closing down, which had 12 beds. And as I said, I mean, the Eddington saved my mum. When my dad was really ill and my mum was finding it really hard to cope, he went into the Eddington, which was only a couple of hundred yards. It was a local place, right? And he went down there and it gave my mum that respite. And these places are invaluable to local communities and to families, you know? And it just disturbs me. You know, that we're in a situation now where, you know, like my mum is, you know, she sold her house and all her money will go into her care, paying for her care. And now she's been moved to the place up the road and they're selling the small place. And we were told by the guy that was buying the place that, you know, in one side of the coin, he says, small is beautiful and it's lovely, but we have to move to this model because it is...
The future.
The future.
That's what he said.
Yeah, the future. And I find it interesting to see that, you know, the Scottish Government are talking about, you know, there's a movement coming in for assisted death, you know. And Esther Ranson's been, you know, saying what she's saying. But you just go, like, what kind of a fucking society are we living in, right? When it's, like, costing, like, £2,200 a week, you know, to keep somebody in a care home. Right, 2,200, right? Well, it's shocking. And there's a wee care home up on the Western Islands as well. It's a really small place, you know? A little place that sits on its own down in North Uist. And I'm sure that place would never be shut. But I mean, you know, down in East Lothian, you know, where we're, you know, well, you know, housing schemes are growing up like cancers around us. It's like, you know, and it's not housing that is kind of affordable either, in the same way as the care homes are affordable, you know. And I find it a bit shameful, you know. And I think, you know, we've got to look at these small places that, you know, rather than shutting things down, you know, when you're living in a county where the bus service is bad enough, you know, and, you know, in the same way as I talked about the Skipton Building Society, and the people who can't get online access to deal with their loved ones' accounts, if they've got a power of attorney, have got to go to the office. And the way that, you know, we've all got to go up to the Royal Infirmary in Edinburgh now, you know. And there needs to be a serious rethink in this country. Now, this is my serious moment for the evening. As you know, I'm kind of flipping it serious every now and again. So I thought I'd play this, all right? Because I'm watching all this stuff going on the telly. And it's... And I'm watching all, you know, the usual suspects, you know, performing in front of camera and all this talk about elections and things. And it's interesting, when this album originally came out in what was it, 1991, it was right on the cusp of an election. And it's strange that this is now... coming out, if I've got the right one here. I think I have I?
I'm talking to us for all those who left.
So a blue umbrella includes the street guards heading out there for the lonely and home. And even you stand deep in his pocket, wrapped up in his bones to keep him in the room. Reason spirit heart. Documentary crews, shooting film as the lights get lighter, as the scenes run out, as the oil runs dry.
stand deep in the wilderness, poison soil, and drink the hearts of blind indifference, greed and apathy, so way back in our history. The fish are few, and the harbors are empty, the keels now rot on the oil-slick shores. The sheep are gone, the farms, the dead, it's out of sight, and we're out of mind.
I went into, yes, we wish the Americans great heroes, but it wouldn't be on this one. Yeah, it's that's the problem when you do segues, right? Yeah, it's funny that, isn't it? John Major, goodbye. That long, yeah. Like I said, I mean, it's, I'm moving up to the islands, and like I know what I'm doing up there as well, right? And it's but it's interesting now that things have changed, and you know. You like I said earlier on, you know, we were watching programmes about the miners' strike, and you've seen things, we've seen the hospitals closing and stuff, and our society is changing so much around us. It's, you know, and it's politicians, you know, it's, you know, no matter who they are. It's interesting. But it's Easter. We remember this today. It was, I think it was Sandra Watson said, how am I supposed to remember it's Easter? It's completely Baltic. It's pissing down the rain. And she said, and we've had been bombarded with Easter eggs in the supermarket since 2 weeks after Christmas. I went, that's brilliant. That's where it's at now, isn't it? What is it? Is it Christmas yet? Because we started selling tinsel already. It's just mental. And I always miss Easter. Like, I used to remember all the eggs. Simone used to love it. You used to like the eggs, don't you? And Simone is doing Easter. It's a big German thing. Yeah. Be very quiet. But yeah, she used to paint the eggs and everything. And I remember rolling the eggs down the hill. Yeah. Why, I don't know. I never really got it. I understood the religious significance of it all, but it was like, you know, why eggs and rolling them down the hill? Study. Right. So listen, have a great weekend. Loads of daffodils and tulips and things going out to relatives and flowers and, you know, blah, 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 you know. And And we are going to be chilling out. Like I said, it's IKEA furniture time tomorrow. And so we've seen that. So it's going to be Swedish meatballs. There's somebody pointing out. Swedish meatballs for lunch. So listen, have a great Easter. Have a wonderful weekend and a great holiday. And I'll see you all next week. And somebody pointed out that it's actually the fourth anniversary of Vision Friday next week. How time flies. Listen, take care, stay alive. Oh yeah, bye, good night.